cannot mandate somebody to wear a mask knowing that that mask is killing people.
You are putting other people in danger. You are.
We're advocating for our rights as granted to us under the Constitution.
I think we should follow the science.
Masks are not theater.
We don't have to accept the mandates.
Destroy them!
Masks have been controversial since the beginnings of masks. Masks have always been political. They have always meant more than protecting yourself from infectious diseases.
People did not want to wear their masks in 1918 any more than people want to wear their masks today during COVID. They were uncomfortable. They made it hot to breathe. There were people who claimed that, just as some physicians did, that they were useless.
Mask wearing became one of the significant elements of citizenship for Chinese people. Both the personal morality and also the public side are satisfied by mask wearing.
It's pretty clear that masking worked in 1918 and 19 as part of a wider toolkit of public health intervention. Fast forward to our time, because masking has been so politicized, it's literally a political act.
The medical use of masks goes to at least in the Middle Ages. People were using pieces of cloth over their face. Plague was, of course, one of the things they feared most. The most famous and most iconic mask of all times is certainly the plague doctor's mask. We've all seen these. They have a kind of long beak sticking out, and supposedly they were worn by plague doctors in the Middle Ages and later. In 17th century Italy, plague doctors had a really bad reputation. All respectable doctors, when the plague arrived, left for the countryside because they did not want to die from plague. So they had a very bad reputation, and the first image of a plague doctor wearing a beaked mask, it's a satire. It's making fun of doctors, making fun of their greed, making fun of the fact that they prey on cadavers, on dying people. And we notice something pretty obvious. All these images are exactly the same. They're actually all copies of a single illustration or drawing that dates from 1656. These masks probably never existed.
Surgical masks started to be used in the late 19th century in the surgical theaters with the advent of germ theory. They were not very widespread. There were lots of physicians who didn't believe that they were effective. They really become used more widespread in the public health context during the Manchurian plague in China in 1910-1911. One Chinese doctor was sent to the region by the Chinese government to try and control the outbreak. The name of the doctor was Dr. Wu Lianqie.
He was educated in Western medicine, he knew about bacteriology, and he believed that masks would protect physicians, nurses, and everybody else from catching the plague in the presence of patients. Not everyone was convinced at the time. One French doctor aggressively told Wu that his masks were absolutely useless.
The French doctor is very arrogant. He doesn't believe he can get infected by the plague. So he refused to wear a mask and went into a patient ward. He got infected and dies a few days later. And this became a big news. People are saying that, look at him. He died because he refused to wear a mask. So this became a turning point for many people there.
The Manchurian plague was all over the news in Europe, in the United States, and across the world, and really popularized the idea that masks were an efficient technology to protect yourself in cases of epidemics.
It's really with the 1918 pandemic, especially in the United States, where mandatory face mask use becomes more widespread.
September 1918, the city of Philadelphia throws a Liberty Loan Parade, the biggest parade in the history of the city of Philadelphia, at the point at which they know that in the port of Philadelphia, there is deadly influenza, and public health officials were telling them at the time to not go ahead and do the parade. But they did. Within a week, they see hundreds of cases. Within several weeks, all of the major hospitals in Philadelphia are full. And within a month, you're seeing catastrophic numbers of deaths, as many as 700 a day. So if you're a public health official in a city like Chicago or San Francisco, they learned that they shouldn't have super spreader events, big parades. They learned that they should close football games. They should not have church gatherings, that probably schools should be closed. And among those measures were mask mandates.
Mayors and health officers and city councils took enforcement of these mask mandates quite seriously, and they ordered their police forces to go out and to arrest anyone who was caught without their mask on or anyone who was wearing it improperly.
But there was pushback in virtually everywhere that there were mask mandates. And in fact, there are a couple high-profile shootings of people who resisted being hauled into jail.
They had to move the courts to outdoors because we didn't want to have indoor courts where people were spreading influenza. When Denver passed its mask mandate, there were so many scofflaws that the mayor made a quip that said it would take the 50% of people who were complying with the mask mandate to arrest the other 50% who weren't if they were going to make any headway at all. As San Francisco struggled to get its second spike of cases under control, it issued a second mask mandate. This one was so despised that there was a group called the Anti-Mask League. The so-called Anti-Mask League were drawn from every sector of society who believed that the government didn't have a right to tell them what to do. The mask mandate went into effect for only 1 week before it was rescinded.
The single biggest and most important factor in how the U.S. dealt with the flu pandemic was World War I. Once the U.S. is trying to fight the flu, was to fight it as if it were an enemy. Those who opposed the draft, didn't show up for the draft, were called draft slackers, were deemed as unpatriotic. So too, you saw the rise of a language of mask slackers or mask scoffers.
Many of the PSAs and the announcements of the time are, do your part because the boys are fighting over in the trenches. If you don't cover your cough, that's as good as our troops being gassed in the trenches in Europe. In 1918, Japan takes a look at the United States, places like San Francisco, and their use of face masks, and decides that, well, if the United States is doing this and the Western world is doing this, this is something that we should emulate.
Japan saw the mask mandates as kind of a hygienic modernity, which means that a mask is a modern Western style of thing, especially in San Francisco, such kind of a city. The Japan turned their view and wear masks during the Spanish flu, and many counties in Japan have mask mandates to ask people to wear masks.
After 1918, face mask use in the United States essentially drops to nothing. Whereas in Japan, you see this drive to continue to use face masks to control against seasonal allergies, industrial pollutants, and that it's not just the sick who are wearing them, but it's also the healthy.
A dangerous virus is spreading rapidly in China, and U.S. officials are very worried that it could come here.
A SARS-like virus has now reached the United States.
This is an evolving situation. Literally every day we learn a little bit more about it.
I At no time in history have we had widespread mask mandates as we had with the COVID-19 pandemic. This was the first time in history that you had worldwide mask mandates.
In places like China, in Southeast Asia, Japan, Korea, etc., getting people to wear face masks during COVID-19 was much easier because you have a society that is already geared up to wear their masks in public.
The communication around this, as we most of us remember, exhibited what some people called a great flip-flop. The head of the CDC in the United States first tweeted that masks should absolutely not be worn by the general public.
Right now in the United States, people should not be walking around with masks.
They were trying to protect the limited supplies of masks for healthcare workers who needed them most. Within weeks, public health authorities, including the CDC, had to backpedal strongly.
One of the important things that we're emphasizing right now is our insistence now on wearing masks.
So the communication in favor of public or community masking was off to a very bad start.
Masking in the US in 1918 and 19 and in 2020 to 2022 exemplifies the ways in which individuals relate to the state. That individuals are more atomistic, more partisan, more polarized, have made choices that essentially prioritize their own individual rights over those of the community.
Masks have always been controversial, and for this very reason, we are unlikely to agree anytime soon about masks. The controversies about masks will continue and continue and continue because they have never stopped being controversial for their entire history.